Good morning.
Good morning.
Today is the last Sunday in August, in the month of August. So August birthdays, you want to come forward for our birthday prayer. You're invited to come up now, August birthdays. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, our times are in your hands. Look with favor on these your children as they celebrate their birthdays. Grant that they may continue to grow in wisdom and grace. Strengthen their trust in your goodness and bless them with your abiding love all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Congratulations. And we'll continue by singing our first hymn, number 728.
Therefore, you are feared.
Since we
are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together, as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the intro for today. Have regard for the covenant, O Lord. Let not the downtrodden turn back in shame.
Arise, O God, defend your cross, do not forget the clamor of your foes.
O God, why do you cast us off forever? Why does your anger smoke against the sheep of your pasture?
Remember your congregation, which you have purchased of old,
which you have redeemed to be the tribe of your heritage. Remember Mount Zion, where you have dwelt.
Do not forget the life of your poor forever. Let the poor and needy praise your name. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Have regard for the covenant, O Lord. Let not the downtrodden turn back in shame.
Arise, O God, defend your cross. Do not forget the clamor of your foes.
Almighty and everlasting God, give us an increase of faith, hope, and charity, and that we may obtain what you have promised. Make us love what you have commanded. In Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for the 13th Sunday after Trinity is from 2 Chronicles chapter 28. The men of Israel took captive 200,000 of their relatives, women, sons, and daughters. They also took much spoil from them and brought the spoil to Samaria. But the prophet of the Lord was there, whose name was Oded. And he went out to meet the army that came to Samaria and said to them, "Behold, because the Lord, the God of your fathers, was angry with Judah, he gave them into your hand. But you have killed them in a rage that has reached up to heaven. And now you intend to subjugate the people of Judah and Jerusalem, male and female, as your slaves? Have you not sins of your own against the Lord your God? Now hear me, and send back the captives from your relatives whom you have taken, for the fierce wrath of the Lord is upon you. Certain chiefs also of the men of Ephraim, Azariah, the son of Johanan, Berechiah, the son of Meshulamoth, Jehizkiah, the son of Shallum, Amasiah, the son of Hadron, stood up against those who were coming from the war and said to them, 'You shall not bring the captives in here, for you propose to bring upon us guilt against the Lord, in addition to our present sins and guilt. For our guilt is already great, and there is fierce wrath against Israel.' So the armed men left the captives and the spoil before the princes and all the assembly. And the men who had been mentioned by name rose and took the captives. And with the spoil, they clothed all who were naked among them. They clothed them, gave them sandals, provided them with food and drink, and anointed them, and carried all the feeble among them on donkeys. They brought them to their kinsfolk at Jericho, the city of palm trees. Then they returned to Samaria." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples.
You with your arm have redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph.
The epistle is from Galatians chapter 3. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. Now, the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to make the promise void. For if the inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions, until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. And it was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring out oil and wine. And he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day, took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these 3 do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our faith together.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being in one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us in the Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures. And ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church.
I acknowledge your baptism and the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. We'll now sing our sermon hymn number 683. People who are required to love God and love their neighbors. Jesus responds by saying that if anyone can do these things, then they will have eternal life. It's a pretty big gift, right? If you can do these things. Well, thinking that he already truly loved God and wanting to justify himself and his selfish actions, the man then asks Jesus who his neighbor is, and Jesus tells the parable. And at the end of the story, then Jesus asks the man one more question about which character in the parable acted like a neighbor. And the man answers, well, it's the one who showed mercy. And then Jesus finishes off the lesson telling the man and all of us to go and do likewise. instead of making the man or any of us feel comfortable, that we're doing what is being asked of us by God, the law is really meant to make us squirm. Because we're not fulfilling it perfectly. It's condemning us for not doing those acts that we are required. And we're not refraining, not stopping doing what we are not to do. We're not accomplishing those good deeds that we are required to do. That law always condemns sinful humanity. It's meant to prick our conscience, not comfort it. The law says, do this, we don't do it. Look at the lawyer who knew what God's word said. He knows those two most important laws of God are to love God above all else and also love your neighbor as yourself. This man wants Jesus to tell him that he's doing enough, that he doesn't need to change his life. But Jesus tells him, go. Do likewise in helping those who are hurting instead of walking away from them. Do you let the law of God adequately convict you of your sins? Just this past week in confirmation class, we're looking at a portion of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount where he's going through the commandments. And it goes through the fifth commandment, the sixth commandment, the eighth commandment. It's kind of a similar framework. Jesus says, you have heard that it was said, but I say to you, and instead of loosening the requirements of the law, Jesus is making those commandments even more strict. Right? Jesus said, I did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it, for us. So while none of us have taken the life of another person in murder, Jesus says that if you call someone a name, you're in danger of the fires of hell. And which of us has not done that? In anger. Even calling our friends names in joking or in a satirical way is breaking the commandment. And we forget that part. We just congratulate ourselves for not killing other people instead of acknowledging that we get angry, that we deserve to be sent to hell for not controlling our sinful tongue. Each and every one of the commandments should convict us and send us further on our way to hell. Not excuse our behavior so that we think we can sneak into heaven. Because, well, I did most of that. After hearing Jesus' parable, are we convicted that we act like the lawyer, the priest, and the Levite more than we act like that good Samaritan? We should be. Who wants to deprive themselves of their own time and money to help somebody else out? We'd rather go out to eat and watch a movie than give someone $10 or $20 to a homeless person. In our minds, we judge that homeless person. We've convicted them of some unknown sin that happens also to make them unworthy of our assistance. Shame on us for thinking and doing these things. There are many people around town that need help in one way or another. And because we think we are better than they are, we refuse to help them. We are like the Pharisees and the lawyers of the Bible. Good luck getting into heaven with that lifestyle, with that attitude. What is it that motivates this Samaritan man to help an unknown stranger who is near death? Why does he do such great acts of love and service to his neighbor whom he's never met and he doesn't know and will probably never see again? It simply has to be that this man loves God with his whole heart. He knows the promises of God. He knows the grace and love of God. And so now he can also share that love of God concerning his neighbor. By faith in the promises of God, the man has learned that because God is loving and merciful to all people, he also makes those who trust in God loving and merciful toward others. Of course, we recognize that this Samaritan, the one good Samaritan, stands for Jesus, our Savior. He helps people, healing, cleansing, forgiving them. He preached that sinners need to repent and receive the grace of God. Our motivation for serving our neighbor is not some requirement of the law, but it's the grace of God that was first showered upon us by God in Christ Jesus. But not only is Jesus the Good Samaritan, Jesus is also our neighbor that fell among the thieves. He took on our human flesh and blood. He was ridiculed, persecuted, and finally executed by his enemies. He was beaten almost to death before they made him carry his cross for his execution. He took his place in the midst of robbers, sinners, and was buried. No one came to Jesus' rescue. No one saved him from death. He received from the hand of God what he did not earn, but what we earned for our leading sinful lives. So now the way that we serve God is by giving our good works to our neighbor who is in need. Only the death of Jesus saves us from ourselves, from our lack of obedience to the law of God. He perfectly fulfilled for us all the righteous requirements of the law. And he gives us his own obedience to be our own, while he takes upon himself all our sins. All our righteous deeds are like filthy rags in the sight of God, bringing our feigned righteousness before God. It's like your cat brings that bird or that mouse and drops it on your steps. Who could be proud of such a thing? But taking the righteousness of Christ on our own, putting it on like a clean new garment, we go out looking for others. Looking for others to serve, because we have first been served and saved by Christ. We love because God first loved us, sending Jesus to die for us, paying for all our sins, earning for us the perfect righteousness of God. Just as many people who heard Jesus' teaching proclaim them to others when they return to their homes, so also those who were miraculously healed from their sickness, from their infirmities, sought to spread the word of God to those who would listen to them. A miracle had been performed. How could this not be the Christ? How can you, who've had this burden of all your sins removed, also not be excited to share the word of God with those around you? Especially those you see who are still struggling under the burden of the law. What all men need is faith in Jesus Christ. Then works become pleasing to God. We serve God by serving our neighbor. We need faith that Jesus' works, not our own, make us acceptable to God. That yoke of Jesus, it's easy. It's light. Believing in him brings us salvation. You pay for your sins. He grants you entrance into the gates of paradise. Following Christ, then, bear fruits in keeping with your repentance. Bear fruits in keeping with your faith, doing good to those around you, not just your friends, but even enemies. In loving others, you show that you believe that God loves and forgives you for Jesus' sake. In loving others, you show that he forgives them. I mean, the peace that passes all our human understanding. Keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus, our Savior. We stand for our prayers. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, your Son has triumphed by his cross. Give grace to your Church to proclaim his victory throughout the world, the victory of that love which hate could not destroy, that life which death could not overcome. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless this parish and preschool, that we may grow in our knowledge of the Lord and our love of his commandments. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sustain and give success to all catechumens and those inquiring into the faith. You have begun your good work in them. Bring it to completion on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, as we have received the love of Jesus, our Good Samaritan, enable us by your Spirit to reach out in love and compassion to others. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hear our prayers for our country and the nations of the world. Overcome war, hate, and bloodshed by peace, justice, and mercy. Keep safe the soldiers and servants in our armed forces, especially those in danger in Afghanistan. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father, into your loving hands we commend those who have requested our intercession, especially Don Pope, Ricky Williams, those in the paths of hurricanes, and Ray Lots, the father of Eve Fellows. Lead them out of all their troubles, Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated. We'll now receive our offerings to the Lord.
It is right to give him thanks for grace.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love, shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns through all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, righteous judgment. You condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of this cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, to shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Thank you.
I got a couple of things after announcements. So don't, if you get your hymnal out, if you don't know, the Luther's asking a blessing before meals. It's on page 327 in the front of your hymnal. You can look that up so you can pray along with us. 327.
Okay, after all that confusion, we want to thank all the guests and visitors that were worshiping with us this morning. We hope you had a joyful Lutheran worship experience. We do take attendance. If you would like to sign the attendance books that are in the pews along the aisles, please do that. There are several bulletins. I have announcements. I would refer you to the bulletin. The only one that seems to have some urgency here is the 2022 LCMS National Youth Gathering. There's a registration form and a $50 deposit that's due on August 31st, so you might keep that in mind. And that's all I have.
Because we're having our kind of back-to-school celebration today, I'm going to ask students, teachers, staff, wherever, so, you know, I know there's other staff members here, stand up. You just stay where you are, just stand up, school kids, teachers, staff, volunteers, aides. She's not getting out of it, is she? Come on, Robin, stand up. Here's our little back-to-school prayer for all of these. Instead of blessing the backpacks, we're blessing the people. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, since you have committed the care and nurture of your children to your people, graciously enlighten those who teach and those who are committed to their care for instruction, that as they grow in stature and knowledge in body and soul, they may all cling to you for eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You can be seated. And let's, if you got to page 327, you have to turn to page 328. So asking a blessing before prayer, before meal. And you might know this, you might have it memorized from catechism if you were here enough time. I don't have it memorized yet. We pray. The eyes of all look to you, O Lord, and you give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. Lord God, Heavenly Father, bless us and these your gifts which we receive from your bountiful goodness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now when we go into the PAC to eat, you can just get in line because we had our mealtime prayer. God's peace be with you.